What does Suzette want to know about the world?
When I woke up this morning, it was a bit late, but I didn't care, so I just went ahead and prepared myself.
My techniques can be like a mom, like a doctor.
Could be a doctor like my mother, yes. My father wanted me very much to be a doctor. You know what would have happened if I had become a doctor? Well, my medicine would not have been recognized internationally. I would have lived in a world with borders. I would have lived in my home country. And perhaps my father would have had to be a man and buy me a job. I wanted to be a man myself, and I wanted to go to the very top of the world, and I wanted to work with these amazing people that got the Nobel Prize and all that stuff. So, you know, with medicine, I would not have been able to do that. With medicine, I would have been forever in the shadow of my father, who was a fantastic doctor.
When did you find out that I want physics in my life?
Have I ever wanted anything else? When I was 3 years old, I wanted to become a woodcutter. We had these raspberry plants in the garden, and I used to lay on the ground, on the frozen ground in the winter, and I used to chop down the raspberry plants with the kitchen knife. Like, you know, hit it until it breaks down. And I would have the raspberry plant, which was about 1 meter tall. I would have it fall over. I would imagine that this is how the big trees would fall over when I would be a big man, and I would chop them with a chainsaw. So that was my first dream job. And then around the age of 5 or 6, I switched to biology. I wanted to research. I wanted to be a researcher like Cousteau. The problem with biology was that it was too close to medicine. I would have ended up too close to my parents. I would have ended up too much in their shadow. But I didn't want to be a grown-up man who is the student of my father. At the age of 6, I decided for physics.
How does it feel to work in Caltech?
Caltech is a nice place. There's a place where you can sort of walk among the gods. That's probably Caltech. Like, you know, you go for a stroll and you run into some guy, and then a little while later, the guy turns out to get a Nobel Prize for something. I mean, that's what Caltech is like. So of the 5 people that I worked with that got a Nobel Prize, only one of them had it before I met him. And that's the one I didn't do anything with.
Can you name these people you work with?
First one was the president of Caltech, David Baltimore. He got a Nobel Prize for his understanding of the viral nature of cancer. Then the next one, David Politzer. I was his teaching assistant for a couple of years, and I did for him Physics 1. So he was teaching Physics 1, which is introductory freshman physics, and I was doing the laboratory. And with the other three were Kip Thorne, Barry Parrish, and Ray Wise. Here I played the role myself in the project that got them the Nobel Prize. They got the Nobel Prize for LIGO, when LIGO detected gravitational waves. And then I told Kip, how about we put our minimal Gaussians on these generators of coaxial hyperboloids and see if we get some sort of laser. Kip said, okay, do it if you want, why not? I did it, and we did get some sort of laser. Then on a subsequent paper, I've shown that if you look at mirror edge effects, you get a slightly better configuration if you go a little bit in the hyperboloid direction. So if you just twist it a little bit. So the optimal beam in this design would have been a hyperboloid, which is not far away from the core. A lot of people have worked on LIGO, and it's a very serious project. But it was an honor and a pleasure to take part in it. And
tell us about the book.
Well, the book, basically, I found myself in the middle of this World War III with Corona, and part of being a physicist is being able to tell truth from lie. I mean, this is what we do in physics. We try to find out what is the truth about the world. And the exercise is similar. If you're trying to look for black holes, gravitational waves, you're trying to look at cosmology, or you're trying to do, or you're trying to predict the future, or you're trying to understand what's going on in the world. So, we find ourselves in the middle of this corona crisis. A lot of people seem to be saying telling us a lot of lies. And to the physicists, they're a little bit more obvious. So the most obvious thing, which is very clearly a lie, or misleading, highly misleading, is that they were trying to get case fatality ratio. So the question is, how many people die of corona? How deadly? And the wrong way to look at how deadly it is to test the people who are very sick and look what fraction of those very sick people die. Because when you do this, you're going to overlook the people who have a mild form of the illness and have a little bit of a cold. They cough a little, sneeze a little, and then it goes. And if you don't take into account this rather large population where corona is a relatively mild illness, you're going to get a very high mortality rate. And this is what happened in Wuhan. In Wuhan, the health system was completely overwhelmed. They were only able to test very sick people. And of the very sick people, many died. So we have a mortality rate of about 5% coming out of war. Nobody can believe that because they've only tested the sick people. So I had to find population groups where testing was completely independent of symptomatology. So I had to find places in the world where they've tested people based on some criteria that have nothing to do with the way they look or the way they feel. These places were generally countries with robust health systems, with good ability to test, and at the very beginning of the epidemic, when they didn't have enough cases to be overwhelmed. So the first example would be China. But I didn't look at Wuhan and I didn't look at Hubei, but I looked at China outside Hubei. And outside the Hubei province, the main reason for testing people has been travel to Wuhan or contact to people from Wuhan and Hubei. So they tested people who are mainly healthy, showed no symptoms, but have been in a train or a plane with somebody from Wuhan or have come from Wuhan. So these were healthy people. And in this population group, the mortality seen in China was 0.18%. Now, 0.18% is vastly less than 5%. It's 25 times less than 5%. And you can't have the same virus kill 25 times more people in Wuhan than it kills outside Hubei. But this 0.18% is believable because here they tested people independent of symptomatology and they looked at how many people died in this. So they basically, the testing was independent of other indications. Then I looked at other countries who did the same things. At the beginning of the epidemic, Germany was testing people based on travel history to Italy or to other hotspots. And in that period, Germany had also the same sort of mortality rate. I think Denmark and Austria and some other Nordic countries did the same thing with similar results. So based on this, I concluded that what one can believe is that the mortality rate looks like 0.2% or 2 in 1,000. Sure, places where the system is overwhelmed, like Spain or Italy, show a completely different picture because they can't test everybody. They end up with a mortality rate looking like 10%. Fear that we see, a lot of this quarantine and all these problems, they are based on the theoretical possibility that corona is very deadly. That the 5% we see in Wuhan is real and that we could be looking at, you know, 5% of the German population die. So 5% of Germany, that would be 4 million people. Now, that's a serious problem. If we have 4 million people die, that's a very serious problem. Whereas the 0.2%, if you infect half of the population, you're looking at 80,000 people dead. Now, this 80,000, even though it sounds like a large number, I wouldn't see it as a problem because you should think how many German people die anyway in a year. And we have 80 million people in Germany. People live about 80 years. If you assume the age distribution to be constant, you got to have one person in 80 die every year. So you have 1 million people dying every year in Germany. Now, if this year, instead of 1 million, we have 1,080,000, that's 8% more. Well, yeah, of course, we have a pandemic. We have a virus that kills people. If in the year with the virus that killed people, we have 8% more people dying, well, that's expected. We have the problem, you know. But that is not the end of the world sort of problem. That is like many other flu epidemics that we've had before. This is not the flu, this is a cold. The coronavirus is in the same category as viruses for these colds. But colds can also be deadly. Like in the same way as you have a normal flu and you have a deadly flu. Like we had the 1918 deadly flu, the Spanish flu, which killed a lot of people.
And then this IQ is kind of a meaningless, flimsy thing for beautiful girls.
Like,
you want to? Can you?